We begin the panel on China. We have three panelists, one more knowledgeable than the other. On my right, Ambassador Nogami from Japan. He and I almost created a new Middle East in the 90s. Today, Ambassador Nogami, you are the head of the think tank, which is adjacent to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and very important. Christina Lin, a very known researcher on Middle East, China, Far East China. Now you are in Europe, I guess. And our former ambassador to China, former a minister, former general, and currently with the INSS, let's not forget that, Matan Vilnai. Welcome to the startup nation, China. Last year, 17 million Chinese were added to the population of China. Just 1 year, 17 million. This is a startup nation every year. And for Israelis, this is a mind-boggling figure, and for everyone in the world, I guess so. My first question to the three of you, is China stoppable with such a mighty figure of population, power, humane power, then to which we have the political willingness, the resilience, and the possibility to add technological military power every year? Ambassador Nogami, is China stoppable?
Yes, I think so.
By the way, channel 2 to those who need translation. Channel 2 on the equipment. Go ahead.
You talked about the increase in population, but at the same time, it is the burden for China as well. Take a look at the total GDP. It's huge, about 4 times bigger than that of Japan. But when it comes to per capita income, still very, very, what you call middle income, you know, country. And given the current Chinese development model, China will have to stay in this middle income bracket for some time to come.
Christina?
I have a different perspective. I think China's sort of rise is an organic development. I don't know if it's stoppable just by virtue of its manpower and GDP and, you know, economic financial wherewithal. And I'm not sure that that's the right question to ask. I mean, it's rising, it's an organic development. And I think that instead of saying, is China stoppable, how can we work with China? How can we engage China in its rise in the global system? And you know, Sino-US relation, I think, is the most important bilateral relation and a key pillar of any future global system. So I think we need to find ways to cooperate. And, you know, there's so much negative press with the you know, military conflict and tensions in the Western Pacific. You know, this is due to legacy relationships with, you know, with Japan and historic rivalry, you know, with other states. So prospects for cooperation doesn't seem very bright in that region, but I offer a silver lining to look here in the Middle East of all places, that this could be a good place to for US and China to cooperate and to engage China. And actually, RAND Corporation just came out with a new report published last month in December about China's role in the Middle East. And this is important for Israel and the US as well. And, you know, it came to the same conclusion that the Middle East is a good venue for cooperation between US and China, because we have overriding interests in regional stability, unfair access to energy sources, and it recommended that, you know, China behave as a responsible stakeholder and take on more, you know, contribute more to regional stability. And not just China, but also, you know, other East Asian energy importing countries such as Japan and South Korea and India, and these are US Asian allies, and if they can cooperate and contribute to Middle East stability, because it affects them as well as energy importers, and they have a cooperative template, then maybe, you know, this could have positive spillover to resolve differences and tensions in East Asia. So I think I'm more hopeful about how we can engage China, not trying to stop China.
We'll get to your optimism in a minute. Matan, is China stoppable?
First of all, we need the Chinese here. A minute. We need on the fourth chair to have a Chinese figure.
We invited.
Next year, we'll take care of it.
Yeah, okay.
We'll take care of it.
I rely on you to do that.
But to answer the question, dozens of specialists all over the world asking this question daily. And on one side, they will tell you China is dominating the world. On the other side, China is collapsing. Not going to collapse, it's collapsing. But it's so big, so you can't see it. But at the end, it collapse. And the main threat to China is within China, like Israel. The main threat to Israel is in Israel, not the enemies around. We can deal with them. The same about the Chinese. And no one can be sure how it will be in the future. But I am sure that the Chinese leaders, every night before they are going to sleep, think about the former Soviet Union of Gorbachev in 1989 and what's happened to them. This is the real threat for China. And no one can know how it's going to be. So they can be stopped by themselves at the end.
Okay. I sort of refrained to do this in the first question, but we cannot, of course, disregard the fact that we have a new president in the United States who said in the inauguration speech only last Friday, and he didn't mention China by name, he meant China certainly. And maybe Japan as well. For many decades, we have enriched foreign industry at the expense of American industry, subsidized the armies of other countries while allowing for the very sad depletion of our military. We have defended other nations' borders while refusing to defend ours, and spent trillions of dollars overseas while America's infrastructure has fallen into disrepair and decay. We have made other countries rich while the wealth, strength, and confidence of our country has disappeared over the horizon. Then he says, every decision on trade, on taxes, on immigration, on foreign affairs will be made to benefit the American workers and American families. We must protect our borders from the ravages of other countries making our products, stealing our companies, and destroying our jobs. Protection will lead to a great prosperity and strength. Did he mean Japan?
It's easy to make that sort of speech, without any thought on the implication. The fact that the United States is respected, and the fact that the United States' presence is needed in Asia Pacific is because U.S. has played its role. How can you be great nation. You know, he wants to make America, you know, great again. A nation, a great nation, does have to have respect. You know, a country without respect from anybody, I think, can it be called great? He's talking about protection, but the number he cites are the numbers in the 80s. The numbers in 2020 will be totally different. You know, for instance, President Trump still thinks that Japan has a huge trade surplus with the United States. Not anymore. That was in the 80s. And now the largest surplus, about 52% of US trade deficit, owes to China. And then comes EU. Japan is down yes, so he still makes his speech on the basis of all these facts and now this new terminology, alternative fact. I don't know what that means, but nonetheless, those numbers he's citing are the ones in the 80s. And if the United States maintain their military doctrine, the forward deployment of forces, they defend as far as far away from their border, he needs allies in Asia Pacific region. Or is he meaning that his defense line will be a physical U.S. continental border? That means U.S. is giving up its role as a naval empire.
It's quite possible that that's what he means.
Huh.
Yesterday, Christina, the President of the United States pulled out of the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. That's basically abandoning the allies on the trade issue. I'm not saying beyond it, but as a trade issue. Is it a vacuum to which China will walk? They are only speaking, your prime minister, the Australian prime minister spoke last night about the possibility of going ahead with the TPP absent the United States. Will China be invited? Will China step in this vacuum created by the United States?
I think China already is with the regional economic, partnership, and this is a reaction to the TPP, because it's difficult to have a TPP that excludes the second largest economy in the world and the largest trading partner for Asian nations. So they are stepping in to fulfill sort of regional leadership, I guess, in trade, but. I mean, I don't think we should see as filling a vacuum or one power supplanting another. I think it's just sort of one power supplementing another's initiatives with these global issues and global trade. China's AIIB is open to the U.S. and to Japan. Israel is a member of the Asian Infrastructure.
AIIB is the Asian Investment Infrastructure Bank, to which Israel is, as Christina said, a member already.
Yes,
Japan isn't.
A founder member, not a member, but a founder member.
Go ahead, Christina.
Not just Israel, but most U.S. allies have joined AIIB, except for Japan and right now U.S. And I understand, from Israel and U.S. perspective, that there's always and the EU, there's been some reservation about China stepping up its role. Filling the vacuum of or supplanting U.S. leadership, but Forbes actually came up with an article about a week ago on the scorecard of the AIIB this past year, because initially there were reservations about China, weaving these international institutions to supplant the Bretton Woods system, Western systems, and there are concerns about how this will empower China at the expense of U.S. interests, or that it will have poor governance and poor standards. But the scorecard in the Forbes article actually has been quite good. What happened was the AIIB actually co-financed a lot of the projects in Asia with multilateral institutions, with the World Bank, with the Asian Development Bank, EBRD, European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, on slum projects in Indonesia or hydropower or the, you know.
But Christina, can China, with all the constraints on free trade, with the government involvement, heavily involvement in running the economy, can it become either because of the United States pulling out or for whatever reason, can it be part of an economic association which is based on liberalism in economy, certainly, which is not yet in China? Can it be a partner to these economies, Australian economy, Japanese economy, which are basically free, less government involvement in running this the economy? Can it be a member?
Oh, did you want to go ahead?
Please.
On TPP, I think one of the only two countries which have ratified the TPP, New Zealand and Japan, I think we are going to urge United States to reconsider and eventually there will be a voice in the United States for reconsideration of this withdrawal declaration. Take Farm Bureau, Farm Lobby, for instance. 25% of U.S. beef exports come to Japan in fierce competition with Australia. Japan and Australia has already signed the bilateral free trade agreement. And if the U.S. is outside of this larger trading framework, U.S. beef industry will certainly lose the market. And are they going to sit idle? Are they going to be silent on this? No, I think there's going to be yet another repercussion, the wave of criticism. Not only the beef, but the many other sectors. So and on China and TPP, I don't think China can join TPP in the present form, because the rules area, President Xi Jinping talked about the guardian of globalization, China as a guardian of globalization. I was wondering, listening to this, which country is he representing?
I would like to say
Matan, yes, please. Hold
on. TPP is American invention. It's American machinery against China. We have to understand it. The American decided to collect all the forces around China against China. So there is a wonderful machine with no engine without the Americans. So you ask if the Chinese can be the engine against China. Think about it. And the Chinese have good relations with all the forces around, with the Vietnamese, Philippines, Japanese, South Korea, Australia, everyone. And they don't need it. They don't need it. And maybe this is the time for China again to take control of the whole area against the American will. Think about it.
Matan, you are confusing between me and the U.S. president. It's not me who creates the contradiction. No, the contradiction is made, but not by
no,
me.
No, but I must add something about the AIIB. The AIIB is a very important machine. In a short time, it will be the strongest bank in the world. It's only a matter of time. And I was in a visit in Sichuan, and one of my assistants called me in the middle of the night and told me, in a short time, Germany and France is going to join the bank. I said, but it's Asia. No, they're going to join. I called the prime minister immediately. And I told
him, The Israeli one, of course.
We have to enter the bank. He said, but we need to have staff work. I said, no staff work. We have 2 hours to decide. And he took the decision. And the circles in Beijing, they start to say, see the Israelis, how smart they are. In the last minute, they enter the bank. This is the story of the AIIB.
Christina, we interrupted you.
Yes, I wanted to get back to your question about how China can be a partner yes. with these liberal systems. Right. I think China can and China wants to, you know, through its AIIB. Like I said, the scorecard has been quite good. They want to learn, you know, they want to work with the West, you know, on improving their standards. You know, they actually, these projects that AIIB financed, co-financed this past year, they've conducted due diligence and looked at societal and environmental and human rights impact. So the standards are getting up to par, and I think U.S. should join so that we could help, you know, China with these standards on these global issues.
I am not so sure about your optimism on this issue, Christina. I'm looking at the 2016 report of the USTR. USTR is the U.S. Trade mm-hmm. Representative, the authority which runs for the United States all the trade agreements, etc. And the report to Congress by the outgoing administration on China WTO compliance. And it speaks very openly about the constraints to free trade, about the government involvement in running certain important sectors of the economy, the government involvement in every big companies. So the question comes back to the how the free world will continue to maintain its trade relations with this China economy. And I think that you're too optimistic about this possibility.
I mean, it's going to be a challenge. It's going to take time, you know, to slowly liberalize and open up. You know, U.S. had the same problem with a similar problem, not exactly the same degree, with Japanese companies and Japanese industrial policy in the 1980s. You know, there was a lot of fear in U.S. about, you know, Pax Nipponica and Japan buying up America, and, you know, Shintaro Ishihara, the former Tokyo mayor, wrote this book that Japan that can say no to America and how they can leverage their economic power to sort of, you know, set U.S. in its place, and if they should stop selling semiconductors to the U.S. and sell it to Russia instead, they could alter the military balance. And that was what prompted U.S. actually to intervene and have our own industrial policy. In 1987, we formed Semitec, you know, semiconductor manufacturing industries, to intervene. Department of Defense formed a consortium, and this is unprecedented in U.S. economic history as a laissez-faire system, that we actually got government to intervene in the industry to save our manufacturing, our semiconductor manufacturing industry. So, you know, we had sort of similar issues with Japan, and I think Japan's opened up, and I think we have to give China a chance. You know, it's a big country, and it's progressing, you know, on a slower pace. But I mean, they have, if you look at it, you know, where they are now, maybe 10, 15 years ago, they made progress.
China has to come up with a new development model. You know, it has been dependent, relying heavily on the fixed capital, you know, formation, investment. This is a sort of program continuing since 2008. And for instance, overcapacity of steel and aluminum and all these industries, origin is 2008. And now, in 2017, this is a very sort of a sensitive year for China. You know, the political transition
yes.
and all these things.
The re-election of Xi Jinping.
What Mr. Xi Jinping has to do is to make Chinese Communist Party vibrant and strong again by 2021. This is a centennial
yeah.
of Chinese Communist Party. And but on the one hand, he has to make the Communist Party very strong. And on the other hand, sort of changing the economic structure. You know, I don't think he can do this, you know, juggling so, you know, easily. Very, very difficult. China is saying that, yes, private consumption is increasing, but yes, for the last 2 years, because of special incentives for small cars and, you know, all these. So consumption really increased because of car sales. But the basic problem of current Chinese economic model is long-term objectives. There's a huge dichotomy
between long-term economic development model and short-term requirements. You know, in order to have a sort of sustainable development, you have to have a sort of more balanced, sustainable level of export and private consumption and fixed capital formation, investment. But I don't think this can be done at the time of very critical, sensitive political year. I think President Xi may be thinking that after the 19th Congress is over, they may go into this more reform mode. But nonetheless, this dichotomy between what is required for long term and what is required for immediate future, you know, this is a serious contradiction. You know, and how I don't know how they're going to deal with this. You know,
Let me move to a difficult question. Given the start of the trade war, given the Chinese ambitions in the South China Sea, given that this is a very sensitive year because they are going to decide on the continuation of the current leadership in the Communist Party, Matan Vilnai, do you foresee a possibility that the economic war will slide, even unintentionally, to a military confrontation around the questions of the South China Sea?
I hope no. I believe that the leaders from both sides are smart enough to understand the meaning of a war, not a trade war, but of a war. And the superiority of the American is obvious, no argument about it. They are much more stronger, but I hope that no war will break between China and the United States of America, because no one is going to win. Although the Americans are much more stronger military from the Chinese, it's obvious, no argument about it. The Chinese understand it very well.
So what was this Taiwan gesture? Was it nobody paid attention? Nobody considered seriously the implications? What did it mean?
Well, then we have to understand the way of thinking of the Chinese is absolutely different from our way of thinking, and my own beliefs, for the good, not for the bad. And they understand very well what they are doing. And they are playing very delicate game in this issue. And we have to understand, in the Pacific, there is a Cold War. There is no Cold War in Europe, and Germany is united. But in the Pacific, Korea is still divided, North Korea and South Korea. And at the end, there is a Cold War between China and the United States of America. We have to know it. This is the day-to-day life there. And the Cold War language is all over there. But I can tell you one thing. I start to ask my people about this, and the intelligence told me, Matan, you are not in the Middle East. You used to fight and all this. You are in this area, in our area, in the Pacific, will be a lot of talks, a lot of small incidents and nothing. That's all. And I hope that he's right.
Christina, is there a danger of sliding from trade to actual military confrontation or confrontations, like Matan said, mini confrontations?
I concur. I also hope not. I don't think so. I know there is so much press coverage about Trump, you know, waging a trade war, but I mean, he's not interested in military conflict. He's interested in trade and job creation and the fact that he appointed the Iowa governor, Terry Branstad, who has very good relationship
ambassador
to China. Shows that he understands the importance of good relations and guanxi, you know, in this bilateral relationship. So I hope not, and I don't think so.
Okay. If it does, is Japan on the side of the U.S., given that the U.S. just abandoned Japan in the trade situation?
Well, actually, Japan and the United States have the security alliance. We are allies. And we are providing the basis for deployment of the U.S. forces, but you know, naval bases. You know, 7th Fleet is home porting in Yokosuka. You know, Yokosuka is their home port. So, you know, there is already a very sort of solid structure there. And the South China Sea and East China Sea, you know, contiguous waters, are vital to Japan. You know, the trading routes and everything, you know, the most crucial, you know, sea line of communication goes through East China Sea and South China Sea and the Strait of Malacca and then to Indian Ocean. So whatever is happening in the East China Sea and South China Sea are vital to our interest. And we are expanding our defense capability, particularly naval defense capability. And also we are setting up various sort of quasi-alliance situation with the riparian countries of you know, Southeast Asia. They're like Vietnam, and even Philippines. You know, we are providing vessels to those countries. So we don't sit idle if something happens in East China Sea and South China Sea. That I think China should not misread the situation. The firepower you talked about, you know, U.S. firepower is by far superior. But if you add Japanese firepower, you know, it's going to be huge. And we have a small defense-only navy, but their capability is extremely high. Yes.
It's encouraging to know that. Please.
But you're assuming that China will act alone. What if Russia joins in and other allies?
China with Russia acting in the north or the South China Sea? That's what you mean?
Yeah, it could be a black swan. I mean, they conducted naval exercises in the region.
Well, you just
there's also the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the SCO.
Christina, you just robbed me of the question. Or you preempted my question. My question was going to be, what if Russia and the United States, under the current leadership, Putin and Trump, reach some sort of a grand bargain on many issues, and China find itself against a coalition, not with Russia, but against Russia and the United States, not against, but these two reaching a grand bargain between them, not with China. That's quite a possibility.
That could be a possibility, but I don't think at the moment.
Okay,
really.
We are running into a certain hypothesis.
Because geography matters, and I think China and Russia have. They have a condominium, you know. It's not, you know, one school of thought where it's just an axis of convenience, a temporary meeting of minds over one short-term interest. Nor is it a full-blown alliance. People are hyperventilating over a full-blown alliance that's going to undermine the U.S. liberal system. It's somewhere in between. It's an alignment of interests of these broad, overarching strategic interests of counterterrorism in their backyard in Central Asia, in Xinjiang, in Chechnya, in the Caucasus. It's about regional stability and regional integration.
Yep.
So they have these broad, you know, overriding interests.
You're right.
While having space to still play out their underlying conflicts without undermining their overall strategic partnership.
Oh, you want
to cut it short? She's absolutely right.
I'm glad that the panel agree on many issues. Let me move to the Israeli angle. If indeed the tensions between China and the United States mount, not necessarily a military conflict, but certainly a trade, investment, etc. issues, Can Israel be, can it find itself in a situation where there is a conflict of interest, those with China and those with the United States, and how should we act to avoid it, if we can?
We have to do our utmost to avoid it. It's absolutely, we understand
it. It's not in our hands.
No, and at the same time, I used to say to the Chinese leaders that the United States of America is a cornerstone in the survival of Israel. And everyone here understands it very well. And as an ambassador to Beijing, I used to say it constantly. The United States of America are the main cornerstone of Israel's survival in the Middle East. You have to remember that not even once the Chinese voted for Israel. Not even once. I asked them why. And they said, Ambassador, it's not personally. And don't take it like this. We can't do.
I wish it was personally.
No. No, it's very important to understand it. At the end, they are with the other side. We have to understand it. And we are playing a very delicate game. On one side, the strategic alliance with the American, that it's obvious to each one of us. And at the same time, a wonderful relations with the economy of China. It's the largest market in the world. And to play this game between
but
the three superpowers, it's not easy.
Hold on for a second. This morning, there was a panel, very interesting one, on cyber, etc. This is a very sensitive area in which, even without Chinese-American trade war, we are already on the borders of a conflict, a serious one, when cyber touches upon security. How do we deal with it?
I can't answer it. It's too simple to answer it. It's much more complicated than you know it. We have to find a way to play the very delicate game between our interests, basic interests with the Americans, and at the same time, not to lose the huge Chinese market. This is diplomacy. And that we did till the last month. I did it till the last month, and I hope that we'll continue with this. And we have to find a way not to choose sides, because it's obvious with whom we are going to go. But at the end, we have not to choose sides, with the Chinese and with the American as well.
Ambassador Nogami, do you face this problem in Japan? I'm sure you do.
Well, actually, there's no split within the Japanese public sentiment. On this, you know, in many countries, security, foreign policy group, and you know, the business interests.
No, I was referring mostly to the cyber development and innovation, which is in many cases as dual users.
Yes, yes, and I think we have to admit that the Japanese cyber capability is still very low. You know, for the level of our economy or for the level of our technology, the cyber capacity is still low. That's why we are trying to sort of develop a better relationship in that area with Israel and also the United States. But we are the target of cyber attacks from China constantly.
Are you victims of cyber attacks from China?
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Not, amazingly, it's not from Russia. You know, it's not from Russia, basically.
No, that is only directed to the United States. Yes. But can you expand a little bit on this?
Well, the problem with this, cyber attacks, there's always a deniability. You know, we trace back all these things, but they say, no, we have nothing to do with it. And so, but nonetheless, those who are involved in cyber area is fully aware that the
China is there. So, and also, in some cases, perhaps North Korea. We don't know. But nonetheless, it's not merely related to cyber. We are facing Chinese PLA naval boats in our territorial water or contiguous water. So cyber is only one part of the confrontation between Japan and China. The China really, coming back to the South China Sea, China wants to make a South China Sea as their inland water. And the East China Sea, they seek to come out of this, what we call first island chain. There are a number of choke points, and they try very hard to get out of this. That is what is actually happening in that part of the, in our part of the world.
Christina, I'm coming back to you, and forgive me if I interrupt your train of thought. You mentioned possibility of cooperation with China in the Middle East. What did you mean by that?
We only have a few minutes left, so I mean, I'll focus on Israel. I mean, just generally on counterterrorism, these non-traditional security challenges that defy territorial borders, and that's too big for any one country to handle, whether it's just China alone or U.S. alone. It's anti-piracy, it's arresting WMD proliferation, energy and maritime security. But specifically for getting back to your question about whether Israel needs to choose between U.S. and China, I don't think it has to, and that's what the Pentagon commissioned, that RAND report, what it concluded. And I think that U.S. should continue to play the role of the key security provider, because it's also what China wants in the Middle East. And China can invest economically, and this proposal of creating perhaps an Israel-Gulf economic corridor via Jordan, this was actually proposed by the Israeli Transport Minister back in September in the Herzliya conference about how with the OBR, the One Belt, One Road initiative, and China investing in these infrastructure projects in the Gulf countries, in Jordan, Egypt, Israel, Lebanon, or in this region, that it could then, through this increased economic cooperation, it could spill over to, more formal ties between Gulf countries and Israel, and maybe have positive spillover to the Middle East peace process. U.S. will still have a lead in the peace process, but I think China has a role in terms of providing economic and trade incentives.
I would like to add, first of all, it's only a matter of time that China will be deeply involved in the Middle East.
Politically or economically?
Everything. They used to see the Middle East, and I quote, the graveyard of the superpowers. But we, the Chinese, are not a superpower. They are superpower. And you know who are they? And they're saying we're not going to be there. But in a matter of short time, because of energy, they will be here. And you have to look at the project in Israel today. All the infrastructure projects in Israel are by Chinese. Haifa, Ashdod, the Red Line in Tel Aviv, everything, they are here. We understand it. In a matter of time, they will be here. And therefore, it's very important to start to learn what is the meaning of China, what is the way of thinking, how they see the world. You have to remember they never were an empire, never. Along the history. Now they have the first time a base out of China in Djibouti. It's in our area. And from their point of view, Djibouti is part of the Middle East. And we have to look at it. So in a short time, they will be here. And therefore, it's very important to talk about it. It's very important to learn them and to study as much as we can. And I understand this is the first time that we have a gathering like this in the INSS. And I really believe that it's very important, and everyone that took this decision, gave my gratitude.
Ambassador Nogami, you and I almost created a Middle East Bank and other institutions back in the 90s. Can you see what Christina and Matan spoke about? A Chinese involvement, certainly in the economics of the region, in a positive role. Can you see that with China?
What China has to do in the coming year or two is increase its control over the foreign exchange. China lost $1 trillion of foreign exchange reserve in 1 year. You know, Japanese foreign exchange reserve is $1.3 trillion. So nearly 11 months portion of our foreign exchange reserve was gone. And also China has to take care of deleveraging of private sector debt, you know, which is now about 230% of GDP, worse than the bubble period in Japan. So they have to take care of that. On the other hand, they have to maintain the value of renminbi, which is now coming close to seven renminbi to a dollar. So I think they keep talking about One Belt, One Road, but do they have gunpowder, firepower? You know, a country which loses $1 trillion in 1 year, can they continue to act as if nothing happened?
We are left with the question mark as we ended our panel, and I thank all of you for coming to this, what I think was an interesting panel. Thank you very much.